our final presentation, we're going to have a tag team on this, so I was going to be challenging for them, I know, is Mike Magoon from the University of Chicago and Steve Hirsch from the Institutes for Behavior Resources. And they're going to talk today about the behavioral economics of transportation, travel time, mode choice, and carbon impact.
We were going to talk about that, but as you can see, we've revised our title, and I want to explain why on my first slide here. Why did we change our title? Though we are definitely not new to behavior change research and technology, we are new to the transportation field. So basically, coming into this, we didn't fully know the known knowns, the known unknowns, or anything within transportation, so we had to get smart. So as we were getting smart, we started to learn that what we had originally intended to do was to do some of that modeling about that Regina was talking about. We realized that a lot of stuff has already been done in travel time and mode choice, ridership forecasting, carbon impact, and all three. So what we said is, well, if we're not ready to put together the models and collect the data, maybe what we should do is introduce our behavioral economic model and see how it can integrate with existing research that's being done. So we have this extremely robust framework of behavioral economics, and we think there are ways that that can happen. So that's our challenge. So just for those of you who may have heard of behavioral economics, and maybe some of you who haven't, I'll bet you if you have heard of it, you haven't heard that there are really two different kinds of behavioral economics out there. And this slide is meant to illustrate the two different kinds. So on the left, you see that there are there's cognitive behavioral economics, and is what I'm calling it. And this is what's associated with the book Nudge. You may have heard of Nudge. And then on the right, you see that there's what we're calling the behavioral economics. And we don't have a book yet. We're not that savvy yet with our public relations. But the basic differences are that the Nudge version, they focus on the cognitive biases that most people learn over the lifetime and how to take advantage of those. They take a primarily deductive approach, and they predict behavior with point estimates. And there's some of the seminal writings you may have heard of, Kahneman, Tversky, and of course Thaler and Sunstein from Nudge. On the other side of things, our approach to behavioral economics focuses on demonstrating direct influences of the environment on observable behavior, and it's primarily an inductive approach that predicts behavior with functional relationships rather than point estimates. And some of the seminal writings you can see there, largely Steve Hirsch next to me, was one of the thought leaders in this field. And I'm going to turn it over to him to talk about some of the basic concepts.
One of the very basic experimental methodologies that we use in our brand of behavioral economics is to map in detail demand functions. In the upper left-hand corner, you see a typical demand function in which we're varying some measure of cost and looking at consumption of some commodity as a function of that cost. On the right, we see increases in expenditure as a function of those efforts to defend various levels of demand. What we've discovered is that underlying all of these demand curves is a very robust and consistent exponential form of function that seems to be cross-species and cross-commodity consistent. And I just give you three examples here on the bottom. You may be surprised to find that the one on the left is pigeons working for grain. The center one is humans working for cigarette puffs, and on the far right are humans who are answering hypothetical demand curve questions describing their purchase of heroin on one hand or nicotine on the other. And yet the functional reform is exactly the same across all of these. It's an exponential decay function. Cost can be defined in many ways. It can be defined in terms of price, money price. More often, we're talking about behavioral cost, either effort cost or time cost. And here we see two examples of time cost demand curves, but you might be surprised to see that these two identical curves, the one on the left is rats working for food in an experimental chamber, and on the right, it's mode choice, in this case, high-speed rail choice, as a function of the time cost of reaching your destination. And yet, the functional relationship is fundamentally the same. And it is expected that at the individual level of the consumer, the same fat pattern is seen here, but it could be scaled up to the population.
And so from a policy perspective, we believe that to make this make any sense and to make a difference on a larger scale, you have to really come at it from a cost-benefit analysis perspective. and making the transition from transportation, its relationship to greenhouse gas emissions. You can see on the left-hand side, that's the same graph we just saw in the previous slide, but that with a constant trip length within certain parameters, as rail trip duration decreases, market share will increase. Okay, and there's some references there that that justify that. And then the benefit side, the case we would want to make for policy change related to carbon impact would be that for the same trip, as trip duration decreases and thus rail market share increases, overall emissions will decrease. But we already know this to some degree, it's in the literature, so what's new? What we want to say is that the principles related to our version of behavioral economics, we've been studying for decades. So some of these things about behavioral measurement, some of these things about consequences and reinforcement, we heard a lot about feedback today. I'm thankful and not surprised to hear the results that we heard today. Our theory and our decades of research would have predicted that more immediate feedback has a greater impact on behavior, so it's good to see that that's holding true still decades later. And some of these things we're learning about stimulus control that we're hearing related to transportation is also not very surprising. So there's lots more. These are just some examples of behavioral principles, their implications for the kind of research questions we could generate with transportation and some of the perhaps policy solutions that could be generated. But again, we're pretty new to the transportation industry and we're looking to find that connection. We believe it's there between behavioral economics as we know it and transportation. So we want to reach out to people and talk about how that might be done.
Wow. Thank you, guys.